On the other hand, this type of method allows you also to do the same separation, but much faster. So if you keep the resolution with UPLC compared to HPLC, you see you can get the same HPLC chromatogram, but in 5 minutes instead of doing it in 45 minutes. So with the same instrument, you can do about 10 times more analysis. So this is very nice to get these fingerprints for metabolomics, because you need a lot of replicates to do this. Okay, then this is coupled to a time-of-flight mass spectrometer. And the advantage of this type of instrument is that they will provide a high-resolution mass spec. And high-resolution mass spec are important because you can get the molecular weight here with a very high mass accuracy and also a good definition of the isotopic pattern. And if you use this two information with the state-of-the-art instrument, you can deduce the molecular formula of any organic molecule directly in the extract. So this is a very important information if you would like to know if the compound in a given extract is known or not. So I would like to show you how we do this. So this is just an example of a UPLC TOF-MS profiling of a crude leaf extract. And you see there is quite a lot of metabolites. And they are characterized in what we call here an ion map by two coordinates. These two coordinates actually on this dimension correspond to the molecular weight. And based on the method I show you with high resolution mass spec, you can extract the molecular formula in this dimension. And the other dimension here is the chromatographic separation. And somehow the chromatographic behavior of a natural product is related to its lipophilicity. So we are also trying now to find out a relationship between the retention time and the lipophilicity, because this can help us in doing the replication for this metabolite ID process. So we need to use different strategies first to validate the molecular formula, because only the mass accuracy is not enough. You need to filter this data, because even if you have a very, very accurate instrument, there is still a high number of hits which will not correspond to the right molecular formula. And for this, you can use rules which are based on heuristic filtering, where actually this is kind of statistical methods which are looking into all possible formula for natural products. And this will somehow throw away possibilities which are not correct. And this is also taking into consideration, for example, hydrogen-carbon ratio or things like that. So this is very important to filter this. But if you do it correctly, and there is the 7 golden rules which are published by Oliver Finn to do this, then on any of the points here, ideally, you will just have a few possibilities. So this will give you already a partial or sometimes a full identification of a given natural product. But in order to confirm this, of course, what is very important, and this is an advantage when you are working with plants, is that you have also chemotaxonomical information. So you have to cross-search this information with information on the genus of your plants. And this is a good way also to confirm if the compounds or if the partial identification that you have done is correct. This was done with you when you came to profile a few plants from Brazil. The chemotaxonomy information was quite important. So we are trying now to develop also an algorithm which allows us not only to extract the molecular formula, but also to try to work on this log P dimension, the retention time. So we have now injected about 300 natural products in a well-defined chromatographic condition, taking into account the different molecular descriptors for these compounds. And the idea now is to predict the retention time of any of these compounds just based on the structure. So if you have an hypothesis for a structure, you can calculate its molecular descriptor. And based on this, you can calculate the log P and have the prediction of the retention time. This works quite well, but it is not extremely precise. I can just show you, for example, an example here for profiling of ginseng. And you see that there is many saponins in ginseng. And this was, for example, we extract the molecular weight of this ginsenoside B2. at this ion mass, 945, we end up with two ions. So there was two compounds which were matching this ginsenoside B2. So based on the structure, we do this calculation based on different parameters that you can calculate with on the web with such as lipophilicity, hydrogen bonding, or things like that. And based on our algorithms, you can predict the retention time. And you see the predicted retention time for this structure was around here. We have over 30 minutes, we have plus minus 1 minute. And you can decide now, based on this, if it's more this one or this one. So that's helping, but this is not, of course, a full proof. I just show you one example. We were working, for example, here on a plant from Saudi Arabia, which was interested because it had some anti-diabetic activity. And the activity of the extract was quite comparable to this anti-diabetic compound, which is on the market. And the composition was like that. So, okay, there were some main compounds. But when we started with the TOF-MS to look at the data, we could see that most of the peaks were related. So we say, it's strange, they are quite related, so let's do an NMR. So we do the NMR of the whole extract, and this is a 2D HSQC experiment, and we could find out that most of the peaks which were correlated in this 2D HSQC spectra actually match quite well one of the main compounds. So we could see that actually, the variation of the compounds in the extract were not based on the main skeleton, but probably just based on change in the sugar sequence. And when we zoom into this extract, we could see that it was extremely complex. You see, if you go to the baseline, you see that there was a few hundred compounds which were analyzed just in a single extract. If you now look at the molecular ion map, you see that this matched with a lot of peaks here above 500, and we find out that more than 100 peaks were having a molecular weight of more than 500. So we could extract the molecular formula of all these compounds, and this was not enough because there was many possibilities. So we get the MSMS. So you know, in mass spec, you can also get all this MSMS data, and based on this, we could do some hypotheses on the sugar sequence of these compounds. So this was one step. Now we are just implementing in the lab. I just get a few results last night, so I just added to my talk this morning. We are, for this MSMS interpretation, you can now use also algorithms which are used also in metabolomics for grouping type of MSMS spectra and see if there is analogy between these MSMS spectra. So this was not done on the example I show you, but on a fungal extract. So we were acquiring many MSMS spectra on many compounds in this extract. And it's very difficult to know if they are related or not related. But you can do this with data mining methods. And we were using here a tool which has been published by Peter Dorestan in California. This is something that you can get on the web. And you see, this is actually all these spots here correspond to each nodes here correspond to a given metabolite. And the system will look at all the MSMS spectra of all these nodes, and it will group together here, 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 or here, compounds which have similar type of MS spectra. So that means that the structure should be related. So if we zoom, for example, into this one, you see this is one of the nodes, and that's all the molecular weight that we could get on an Orbitrap system here with very high mass accuracy. So two of these compounds are known. These are compounds that we found in a fungal extract. And we could find out that all these other molecular weight were having probably, we don't know the structure, that's just hypothesis at the moment, but we could find out a relationship between this structure and these two known compounds just based on MSMS spectra because they were grouped in the same neural network. So that's a very interesting tool, I think, to predict structure just based on MSMS, even if you don't know the information. And you know, if you take, for example, one of these compounds, and now, which has a mass of 557, so it's over there. If you do the MSMS at very high resolution, the good thing is that you can get the molecular formula of each fragment. And based on this, you can predict fragments and do quite a bit of structure analysis, even if you don't know the compound. So following a similar strategy, we were able, for example, in the case of the plant from Saudi Arabia, to predict quite a lot of structures. But and some of them were interesting because they were having appetite suppressant effect. So we are trying to work better on these compounds. But of course, for final identification, you need NMR. And how to get this NMR spectra with small quantities, that's what I'm going to show you now. So we are using now this capillary NMR setup in order to get NMR information as a complement to the TOF-MS information for structural identification. So we have been using LC-NMR for quite a long time during the 90s with Professor Stedman in our lab. And the technique is working, so actually you can get NMR spectra of compounds that you can separate on the HPLC dimension. But the main problem, if you start to look at very minor constituents, the method is not sensitive enough. So instead of now having a direct LC-NMR coupling, we do it at line. So we do an LC-MS profiling. We collect the peak by semi-prep LC-MS. And based on this peak collection, we analyze then the fraction directly by reinjection into the NMR through this capillary LC-NMR probe, where we inject the pure product, we park them into the probe, and the probe here is much more smaller than a normal tube. The probe has only a 5 microliter volume, so it's much more sensitive because of the reduced dimension, and with this type of probe, we could analyze, for example, this type of alkaloid, for example, at the 2 microgram level. So we were really at the limit for our probe. This is already quite an old technology. It has about 8 years. But now you see with 2 microgram of alkaloids, if you use, for example, these microtubes, and you go on a cryoprobe system, which is now the state of the art things, and this was measured in the States by my colleague Mark O'Neill Johnson, you see that's the type of proton NMR spectra that you can get with only 2 microgram of compound. So this is quite nice because it's just one HPLC peak. And I think this is a very, very nice tool. So we have this similar system. We collect the peak from an HPLC extract. We microfractionate the extract in a 96-well plate. And then overnight, you can analyze the proton NMR spectra of each peak in an extract. And this gives you already very interesting complementary information to the mass spec for the identification of your compounds. So that's a little bit our strategy. We do this microfractionation. This is a 50 milligram extract separation. We get microfractions. The microfractions are dried, analyzed by NMR, and then we can get the proton NMR spectra of most of the metabolite by this way. Now, of course, it's very nice to get structure, but of course, you want to have bioactivity as well. So based on this technology, we try to develop a kind of miniaturized heat discovery platform where we try to also assay the activity in this 96-well plate. So on one side, we get the NMR spectra, and on the other one, you can do bioassay. But when you have a very small amount of compounds, you have to find out the best bioassay. You cannot do 1,000 bioassay. Of course, then you need milligram amounts. So the best one are probably an in vivo bioassay. So how can you do an in vivo bioassay with a few microgram of compounds? There is now interesting bioassay which are based on the zebrafish model. And zebrafish now is an established model in pharmacology. So in collaboration with the University of Leuven, we use this zebrafish to do the assay on the few microgram of compounds that we microfractionate by HPLC. And for example, we are using an assay. Well, there is different type of assay that you can do on these fish. I would like just to show you what we are doing with a behavioral assay. We are looking, for example, for compounds which have anti-epileptic activity. And so we select plants which are known to have some anti-epileptic activity. We do the microfractionation in 96-well plate. And then we use these small zebra. They are extremely small, you see, less than 1 millimeter. And they live very nicely in one of these wells. So I would like now to show you the behavior of an epileptic zebrafish. So I hope it works. This is a small video. So here, yeah. Should work, yeah. Here you have a zebrafish which is normal. You see, it's very quiet in a 96-well plate. on the right, here I have a fish.